Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick in the Philippines. I want to make a third video, and I want to do a little teaching because the Lord prompted me. You know, almost every time I preached, I hardly ever repeat something that the Lord gave me. You know, I usually just give something that's like new. One time, the Lord had given me a sermon called The Three Keys to Victory, and then I think I made a video a long time ago on my channel when I started my channel about that topic. And I taught this and preached this back in the States. But the Lord kept giving me the more details of it and build on it and build on it and build on it, all the details of each of the three keys to victory. Now, if you are one of my regular viewers, you know the other day I made a video about repositioning yourself. You want to go watch it. It's a great video. I think I had lots of good comments that it was a good video. I just made it within the last week. It was called Reposition Yourself. It's time for the rapture. Reposition yourself. And I talked about the GPS, which uses like three satellite signals to locate you. And so just yesterday when I was out of the house, around and about, the Lord just began to speak to me about giving repositioning yourself for the three earthly things that the Lord gave us. Now, the other ones I gave you was being right with God the Father, and with the Word, with His Word, who is also, Jesus is also the Word, but the written Word of the Lord, and His Spirit, with the Holy Spirit, the three that bear witness in heaven. Now I want to talk about on earth. The Lord gave me this message, like I said, probably 2003 or 2004, and the Lord keeps bringing me back to this message, and it's the three keys to victory. Okay, and so we'll be looking at King David before he became the king. Samuel chapter 16 and chapter 17. I won't sit here and read it to you because it can kind of be, monotonous if I just sit here and read. But the text I'm using as a reference is 1 Samuel chapter 16 and 17. Okay, three keys to victory. Okay, this is the three things you need to reposition yourself on earth to go in the rapture, to go to heaven if you die today before the rapture. You need these three keys, and you need these three keys for victory here on this earth, brothers and sisters. That's really the most important thing. This is the three keys for victory on earth. The other three keys, the GPS that I mentioned, repositioning yourself, was the three keys for really going to heaven. So let me just make sure I say that properly and get it out there. This is three keys for victory on the earth. They're also, of course, you need these to go to heaven, but not necessarily all of them. Okay. The first key is that King David had a pure heart. He had a pure heart. He had a heart. He was a man after God's own heart. So God had rejected the first king. The people wanted a king, and God said, I'm your king. But they wanted a king. They wanted a king. So God gave them a king that they would want, a real tall guy. Said he was a head and shoulders above any other man in all of Israel. That's King Saul of the tribe of Benjamin. And he turned out to be, bad, as the Lord had said he would be, and the Lord knew he would be. Because that's what the people wanted, And so God said, I've got a man that's after my own heart. So he sent the prophet Samuel secretly without telling, he didn't tell King Saul because he didn't want King Saul to kill him. And he didn't want King Saul to kill the new king who was going to be King David. Okay, King David was only a youth. He was a teenager. We don't know how old he was. Lots of people say 17. I think we can't really calculate it exactly. But he was a young man. And, definitely under, say, 25, probably more teenager age. And anyway, the prophet Samuel went to Bethlehem, which is where he's from. Jesus is from Bethlehem, so was his father David. And when I say father in the Bible, anybody that your great-great-great-great-grandfather was still called your father. Okay, so that's why one of the names of the Messiah is the son of David. He's the Messiah, the promises God made to King David. So King David was there as a teenager, and he was tending the flock of sheep in the wilderness, in the hill country. And Samuel came to his house, and I forgot now, I think he had seven brothers, maybe six or seven brothers. And the prophet Samuel went there, and he talked to the Lord and saw the oldest son, that he was tall and handsome and all this, and said, oh, this must be him. This is the guy. And God said, no, stop looking at the outward appearance. Like King Saul was tall, great big tall guy. And so he was like, he must be great because he's so tall, So God said, don't judge by the outward appearance. Men judge by that. I judge by the heart. So David is a man after God's own heart. So the first key to victory is to have a pure heart. So what does that mean for us? That means to be born again, to be repented, you know, to repent, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and He will strengthen you. He will purify you by the blood of Jesus, by the word of your testimony, confessing that Jesus Christ is Lord. That's the command He gave us, that we believe on the Son of God. Okay, so that's the first one. Then, after Samuel found David, he anointed him with oil. He poured oil over his head, anointed him as king. Okay, and so the second key to victory on this earth is the anointing. You don't really have to have the anointing to go to heaven. When you get saved, you're sealed with the Holy Spirit, and you have a wellspring of living water in you, like John chapter 4, like the woman at the well, and living water that the Lord gives us to drink that we would never die, have eternal life in Him. That's what you get when you get saved. You're sealed with the Holy Spirit. You got that wellspring of living water in you. Now, there's the baptism of the Holy Spirit, a river of living water. Out of your belly would flow a river of living water, John chapter 7. Now, that's the anointing that I'm talking about. And then, not only to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, but there are many fillings, to be filled, to be renewed, continually filled with the flow, to have the river of the living God flowing out of your belly. You know, now, that comes from when the Lord gives you His Holy Spirit, but when you need to do something, like when I'm getting ready to preach, or if I'm going to pray for somebody, and people who know have experienced the presence of the Holy Spirit, you know that it begins to move when you pray. It begins to move if you proclaim the gospel. It moves when you preach. It moves when you lay hands on people and pray. You know, it moves when the Lord is trying to get your attention to warn you of something, maybe. Whatever, then you feel the presence. So you're being filled with the Holy Spirit for a specific purpose. So there's different feelings of the Holy Spirit. So what you need for victory, and God gave you a purpose. And I just mentioned that in the last video that I made just before this. If you click under my name, under this, see the video I just made 2 hours ago. God gave each of us a race to run. It's the end of the race. We're at the end of the race. Okay? You need the tools that God's given you to finish the race. I already gave you the video I made last week. You need to watch it. The rapture is now, something like that. Reposition yourself. Time to reposition yourself. So now, these are the keys that God has given you. This is the three keys that God gave you to finish the race. This is the keys He gave you to have to finish your race and make it into the kingdom of heaven. So the first key, as I said, is a pure heart. So that means to be born again. And then secondly, we should desire the things of God. If we're truly born again, the Bible says His Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we're children of God. It's Romans chapter 8. And those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. That's Romans chapter 8, verse 14, and also verse 16. So we're led by His Spirit. We're children of God. So if you have a pure heart, if you're really born again, you'll be led by the Spirit. You'll be led with a desire to read the Bible. You don't have to read it 10 hours a day, but you have a desire to inquire into the things of God. You'll have a desire to pray. You have a desire to worship Him. You'll have a desire to do something out there in the external world to be salt and light. Jesus said nobody lights a candle, puts it under a bushel, you know, hides the candle, but you set it up, you know, to be a light. You know, a light, you know, a city on a hill cannot be hidden. You know, the light shines out. So you should be above. You know, a city on a hill is above, not below. You know, and the Lord says that we should be above, not below. So if you're a Christian and you have a pure heart, then you'll be reigning and ruling above, far above all powers and principalities, seated with the Lord Jesus Christ in heavenly places, the Bible says. We're far above those things. So if you're far above and walking with the Lord, let your light so shine before men that they would see your good works and glorify your Father that is in heaven. So a city on a hill cannot be hid. If you're a Christian, you can't hide your light. You know that song, "This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine." That's what you should be doing. You should be above all those powers and principalities because that's where we are in Christ. That's His promises to us. Far above all powers and principalities. Seated with our Lord Jesus Christ on His throne in heavenly places. Hallelujah. We have access to the throne room. We don't have to wait for any special days. Romans chapter 14, there's no special days for us in the church. It says we can come, in Hebrews, that we can, I think it's the last verse of chapter 12, we can come boldly before His throne of grace to obtain mercy. Because of the blood of Christ, by our faith, we Christians, we in the New Testament, we don't have to wait for no special holidays. We don't have to wait till Sunday morning and go to some building built by man, and then, you know, because the pastor's close to the Lord, we can enter into the Lord because of the pastor. Or because of the worship leader. No, we can boldly enter into His presence anytime we want because we are children. Not as the New Testament tells us. You know, there was a slave woman named Hagar, and she had a child named Ishmael. You know, the outside son, illegitimate son of Abraham. And then Abraham had one legitimate son, that's Isaac, who was the child of promise. The Apostle Paul compares Ishmael and Isaac. Ishmael, you know, of the bondwoman is the law. The Old Testament is Hagar, the bondwoman, and her son. They're servants. But the chosen elect, the Bible tells us, is the seed of promise, which came through Isaac and through Jacob, the nation of Israel, down to the tribe of Judah, where we got Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah. That's who we're adopted into as children of Abraham. And we're children where we can cry, Abba, Father. We call God Abba, Father. We don't have to call him in all these formal names. Do you go home and call your dad? Hello, John. Hello, John. Whatever your last name is, if your dad's name is that. Or hello, Ed, whatever. No, you don't. You say, hi, Dad. Hi, Abba. Hello, Abba. Hello, my Heavenly Father. You know, like that. That's how we are allowed to talk to God, because we're Christians, born again, New Testament, children of God, adopted through the blood of Christ. Okay. So we have the pure heart. Then we have the anointing to be filled with the Holy Spirit to do the mission. Like right now, while I'm speaking, the Lord is filling me with His Spirit to do it. I need the anointing. I cannot preach in my flesh. When you have preaching in the flesh, that's where you have some written down sermon and you have your 3 points of expository preaching. Tons of dead churches doing that. Catholic liturgy, where they keep repeating and repeating the same thing. You know, offering, you know, supposed to be the sacrifice transubstantiation, they call it. Look that up. They literally believe they're eating the body and blood of Christ, and He's perpetually sacrificing Himself. Whereas the Lord said, it is finished. He did die on the cross. He's not dying on the cross. It is finished from the foundation of the world. As a matter of fact, it's already done and over with. He's not on the cross anymore. He's seated at the right hand of the Father, far above all powers and principalities. We, as Christians, born again Christians, are seated with Him in heavenly places. Okay, the Lord keeps having me say that. That's how it works. When you're being led by the Spirit and filled with the anointing, you do those things. The third one is faith. You need faith. Okay, King David, when he was still a lad, he had already been anointed with the oil symbolic of the Holy Spirit. He had already been called by God to have a saying that he had a pure heart, a man after his own heart. King David was a special person in those days. We can become born again. King David could not become born again. He was just like any other child of Israel in that covenant with the sacrifices of lambs and all that. But God chose him and anointed him for a special anointing to be a king and a worshiper and a priest. Really, he was a worshiper, king, priest, second only to Christ in his role. Not like Moses, who did ceremonial stuff. King David was a worshiper, a man after God's own heart. That's why God honored him with letting his seed be forever. There would someone sit on his throne forever. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord honored King David for his worship of him. And he played the harp. The anointing came, and the evil spirits left King Saul. That's also in the same text, 1 Samuel 16 and 17. Anyway, so this is what David said. When he was a teenager, he went there, just like us, okay, and he brought some food to his brothers who was in the army of King Saul, facing down the Philistines with Goliath the giant. And his brothers were like, oh, you're just trying to show off. You think you're somebody, just go home. Because King David, the young man, was interested in, you know, what's going on with Goliath and why is nobody killing him and all that. So his brothers, just like our relatives who are not anointed and not full of faith, even though they could be, they're not, and they're mocking him and making fun of him, saying he's just a clown. That's what people do to us. That's what people's done to me, and that's what people do with anybody that's trying to serve the Lord. He ignored that. King Saul even tried to make a joke out of him and give him his great big armor that was so big. King Saul was like a giant man, and here David was a short young kid, and King Saul was trying to make a clown out of him by getting him to put on his armor, you know. So they were mocking him, really, and teasing him. But what did David say? By the anointing, by his pure heart, by the anointing, by his faith. His question was, to the whole army of Israel was shaking in their boots and hiding from this giant to challenge him. And King David, a teenager, little short guy, said, who is this uncircumcised Philistines who challenges the army of the living God? You know. And then King David got the stones and he went out there, and then Goliath said, you know, you send this little punk out to me, this little runt out here, this little punk out to me, and here I am, you know, the mightiest man of Philistines. Is this some kind of a joke? And what did King David do? He said, he proclaimed the word of God. He confessed. He said, you come to me with a sword and a stave, but I come to you in the name of the Lord. I come to you in the name of the Lord. And then he confessed his faith. He even confessed what he was going to do before he did it. He said, today I'm going to chop off your head and give your body to the birds of the air. He confessed it. And then, to top it all off, if you read this story about mighty faith, mighty anointing, and mighty-hearted young guy, King David, it says that when he came to the giant, He started running toward the giant with his sling with a stone in it. He ran toward the giant. He didn't run away. He didn't stand still. It says he charged toward the giant with a sling and a stone. And that's it. And he came in the name of the Lord. He proclaimed it, confessed it, and did it. So that's part of faith. You have to believe it, you have to confess it, and you have to execute it. And King David prophesied by the power of the Holy Spirit and by faith that he was going to kill Goliath and chop off his head and give his body to the fowls of the air, which he did. And the whole Philistine army ran away. Now that's the victory that the Lord has given us, and the victory that we can each have over whatever's in our life, whether it be killing a giant or whether it's overcoming, you know, the mountains in our lives to do God's will in our life. And God has given us these tools, these three things that you need. You need to be born again. You need to have a pure heart. If you're born again, you're a backslider. You need to humble yourself. God gives grace to the humble. You need to rededicate your life. You need to seek His mercies are new every morning. And ask the Lord to help you overcome the things in your life that easily beset you and easily stumble you. Okay? Number two, you need to ask the Lord to baptize you in His Holy Spirit, fill you with His Holy Spirit for what He's called you to do, whether it be a preacher, whether it be a cook at a church or at a homeless shelter, or to drive people to church, or to go visit people, go pray for people, go visit the pastor and take him some food and pray for him, whatever the Lord's called you to do. Go do it and ask the Lord to anoint you to do it. And then have faith to believe all things are possible to those who believe. Believe, and you shall have whatsoever you believe. Mark chapter 11, verse 22, 23, and 24. Have faith in God, Jesus said. For whatever you say, believing you say, say it. You will have whatever you say. If you believe it, you have to believe it in your heart. You will have whatsoever you say. So you've got to confess it. Say unto this mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, and not doubt in your heart. Not doubt it in your heart. That's called faith, brothers and sisters. And you might say, God, give me faith. But the Bible says God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. Now, there's a special gift of faith, but every man has the measure of faith that we need. And then if you need special grace, special faith at that moment, the Lord will give it to you. The Lord will give it to you. Have faith to believe for faith. Have faith to believe for the Holy Spirit. You want to receive the Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit? God already gave the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. You don't have to, He doesn't have to give it to you. You have to receive it. It's just like salvation. It's there. It's just like electricity to an electrical outlet right here. I can cut that electrical outlet off, but the electricity is still right there. All I got to do is just flip that switch, and the lights come on. I don't have to understand it. The problem with lots of intellectual people, especially men, who are religious, they want to understand it. We don't even really understand how electricity works. You know, there's lots about electricity. Only this guy, Nikola Tesla, is about the only one that really knew more about it than all the people today. But there's a mystery to electricity, but we know it works. Right there's the switch. Cut it on, the light comes on. Turn it off, the light goes off. But the electricity is still there. Same thing is true with the Holy Spirit. It's right there. Your faith is what turns it on. Your faith activates God's will. God, the Bible says, it's, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Hebrews 11, verse 7. You have to have faith to please God. You have to have give your undivided loyalty and heart and trust to the Lord. And God will make a way for you, brothers and sisters.